Welcome to Sport Accord World Mind Games, round 6 of Chess Blindfold competition. We are following the game between Levon Aryan from Armenia and Wang Hao, a young, talented Chinese player. Aryan is so far a solo leader here. Just 2 rounds to go, so he has his last chance to prove that he's one of the best players here. I mean, he didn't get it well so far in the previous tournaments. We were expecting him to fight for first places, but he has no medal so far, so...
Yeah, Aryan is the top seed overall in this tournament. I think we easily expect him to have picked up a medal by now, not even to say that probably a gold medal. But so far it's been a tough tournament for him in the Rapid and Blitz, but in the Blindfold he's done well. He's leading now with 4 points after 5 rounds, and he's being trailed by half a point by Peter Liko from Hungary, Shakriyar Mamedyarov from Azerbaijan and Hikaru Nakamura from United States. But quite curiously, Levon Aryan has played all these 3 players, so to get a player for him we had to go further down the standings, and he's playing Wang Hao from China, who has 3 points now, which means that, well, Wang Hao really needs to win this game to catch up to Aryan. On the other hand, if Aryan wins this game, he puts himself in a fantastic situation for gold. So this is a game where both of them has really a lot to win, and I think we are looking forward to an exciting fight in this game. And as we can see, the game has just come up. We have 8 moves here already.
And we can see a Grunfeld opening, and the line which is in recent years considered as one of the main lines. I would say it's getting more popular last years.
Yeah, Wang Hao has played a slightly surprising move on move 5. He plays queen a4 check, which is a bit... he plays queen of a4 check, we can see here. And then when the bishop goes to d7, he puts his queen to b3. Normally you will put the queen directly to b3, but he's trying to say that the bishop is clumsy on d7. And, as we can see, Aryan later put the bishop here to c6, and now after e3 he took on f3. And we have a pretty unbalanced position here. White has the pair of bishops and more space. Black will say, I will try and undermine the center here. But I quite like white position here in some sense. But I think it's a very good position from a spectator point of view. We had some very symmetrical games that were a bit dull. Now we should see really a huge fight, I would say.
Well, in general, in such positions, when white has a pair of bishops and more space, we usually say that it's better for white. So
I agree, but here.
Okay. However, white is still not. White didn't finish development yet, so black has some time to find a counter play in the center or even on the queen side. So
I think he will try and play something with knight d7 and e5.
Yeah, if black can manage to play e5, and then next moves can't bring unclear position here.
So it's an interesting situation right now, and Wang Hao is taking his time. No, he just moved. He put the bishop on e2. I still think knight d7, maybe rook e8, e5. I think generally black should be doing quite well here. I think Aryan has reasons to
even
be.
Even knight h5, I mean, first knight bd7 first, of course, and then black can try to get some extra tempo by attacking the bishop.
I think it's the Armenian player is doing quite all right. It's very, very much too early to say that there's been some kind of decisive development, but I would say that the small things are going okay for black, but still, I would say pretty equal position, and anything can happen here. We can also talk a bit about the situation in the women's section. There we have a quite surprising leader. This is Victoria Chmielytė of Lithuania. She has 4.5 points after 5 rounds. Half a point ahead of Hu Yifan from China, the top seed and the 3 times former world champion. And then we have 5 players on 3 points. So right now it really looks like a battle between Chmielytė and Hu Yifan for gold. But there is 3 players who are sort of 5 players on 3 points who still has a slight chance to actually...
Some players can't be satisfied after this first tournament, Rapid and Blitz, and I think Victoria Chmielytė is one of them. I mean,
yeah, she
now she's doing well in
her
Blindfold.
Rapid was bad. In Blitz she was 5, which actually above her seeding. But I think you're right. And also, I think she's a good Blindfold player. Last year she was second after Hou Yifan. And, well, actually the situation was exactly the same. Chmielytė was leading with 4.5 points and Hou Yifan had 4 points. But Hou Yifan managed. We could be in for the same situation, or we could be in for that Chmielytė this time manages to hold her lead to the finish line. This will also be. pondering a bit.
In previous games, we could see Aronian play very fast, and now suddenly he started to think. Of course, his position is not easy, so
I think he wants
to find the right plan.
He wants to
must spend some time here, but
White has a very good grip on the center, so Black has to attack it. But he's thinking, should I attack it with the move e5 or should I play c5? And he played c5 here. It's actually an interesting move. I think if White takes it, he wins a pawn, but Black will immediately play rook c8 and create counterplay.
Yeah, White still needs some time to end the development, and in the meantime, Black is fighting for
a
central
pawn. He can't
really
play the move d5
squares.
Because then knight b6 is strong. So I don't know. Somehow, my feeling is that Aronian can be completely satisfied with the development so far.
Yeah. Well, it's not an easy decision for White now. Probably d takes c5 is the only option, I think, because otherwise. Yeah, after
rook
c8, we
play b4. So
well, b4 looks really risky but
even the existing moves knight d5. But I think then you would just take the knight and sacrifice the exchange. But this is an interesting position. Okay, we see here.
Rook
he took
c8.
Rook c8.
Of course, White can just make a castle now and.
You can castle, but okay, rook c5 and knight
yeah,
c5.
Yeah, black.
No,
black
I agree.
Is fine. I mean.
But so is White actually. I mean, if you castle and rook takes c5, queen b3. It's very solid. I mean, maybe actually, I think Guan Hao is not gonna risk the move b4. B4 is a very ambitious move, but I would be surprised
no,
if the
I
Chinese
don't
player goes with
play
I think he's going
here.
For a solid option. Well, for Wang Hao, you can argue it's his last time to fight for gold. Whoa, we had the move b4, and Aronian immediately took on c5. Okay.
Wow.
Wow. Maybe the idea is after bc5, he will play the move queen a5, and he's threatening rook takes c5. Simply just winning the piece back. Aronian played this amazing move instantly.
Well, it looks like he has analyzed this position before.
Maybe he has, but no,
or
I think Aronian
this
is
similar position. I mean,
a very strong tactician, but
but
we could be in for
to play such idea in blindfold after a few seconds is just amazing.
But it's possible that we have a knockout here. I mean, in the sense that how is White gonna not end up in a bad position? Okay, he can castle, rook takes c5, and then maybe the move queen b3. And when you take on c3, you take on b7. Okay.
Yeah, but
White is still kicking. I mean, I think we agree?
Yes.
Okay, now by some technical error, we are getting the game from the previous round. Yeah, this is we apologize for that. We are, of course, still following the game.
But we can see on the screen that Van Gaal is thinking very hard
now. Okay,
now
we are back here. Okay, they
let's go back and see what happens
here. Okay.
Ah, so he just castled and rook c5, queen b3, probably the best way.
Yeah, we spoke of this.
So
and okay, he took on b7, and we got the move knight h5. I think White has to play a bit careful here, but then he should be able to save the draw. But no, it's clear that it's Black who's putting pressure. Also, the bishop on g7 is sort of eyeing the white rook on a1, and the pawn on a2 could be weak. I think it's safe to say Black has a definite advantage here, and it's White who has to defend for a draw. He might be successful in that, but I think it's a difficult task, actually. I think White is in trouble.
White needs to play very carefully in this position now.
So
actually, we can see that it's a nice example of how risky it is to leave the king in the center in the opening.
We can see this very crucial moment here, b4. We said this was an interesting move. We wasn't
White
exactly sure.
White took a pawn,
sure.
But with
now
the king in the center, it appears that
this
Black
piece
has
sacrifice,
very nice
yeah.
options to sacrifice
he
the piece.
He took and queen a5. We can see that the queen on a5, it's pinning the knight, because the knight cannot move, because the king is on e1. And next move, whatever it happens, he will play rook takes c5, and there will be pressure in the c line. And let's say now, White could defend with rook c1. But you will just take on c5 with the rook, and when the queen goes away, you will put the other rook to c8, winning the piece back. Okay, we got now an update here in the game.
Rook ac1 seems to be pawn sacrifice, but
I think there was simply no other way.
Yeah, maybe because anyway, Black has always the option to play rook
as
c2.
As a minimum, he can take there now, and he can play queen takes a2. But I think also what happens, rook takes c1, and now queen d2, attacking the rook on c1 and the bishop on e2.
Well, it looks like.
Are we talking about White having to resign here?
Yeah, White is simply losing a piece after
queen
d2.
Seems to me that he's losing a piece.
I don't see any.
We are in with a
solution
very
here.
Quick game here. It's a very surprising situation. actually. As
we can see, Valerian just took on C1 immediately, so...
Yeah. I think he was... Aronian was really... He's a tricky player. He sees what tricks instantly, and he was really hoping for this thing to happen. I think... Okay, this is a fantastic situation for Aronian. He has...
We can see on the screen that he already took on E2.
Yeah.
Queen takes E7, so he's just simply pissed up in this position.
Yeah. Okay. Well, he's gonna play on a bit, but I think that... I would say almost 99%. Okay, it's blindfold, so let's say 90%. Aronian is gonna win this game, and he's gonna take...
It means that he's actually 90% gold medalist in this tournament.
He still has to maybe not lose the last game, but he actually has a chance of winning the tournament before the last round, but that depends on the other results of, the other games. That it's still a bit unclear to say, but this is definitely Aronian's huge chance for gold, but it will depend a bit on the other games. So we should keep an eye on what's happening in the other games of this tournament. But this is a sensational development. Normally you will see very long, games we had in our previous coverage. They were having long technical fights, but here Aronian with some very aggressive tactics managed to immediately decide the game.
Few accurate moves. And
yeah, you have an extra piece, and in chess, okay, an extra piece is if there's nothing very extreme going on, and extra piece means win of the game.
And we can see Aronian is playing very fast.
Yeah,
so
he could take
really
on A2, but he plays A5, is even more ambitious. He's keeping an eye on the pawn on F3, and the A2 pawn is also hanging, I think. It's simply a...
Well, obviously white has no compensation.
Massive, decisive
here,
advantage for the Armenian player. I think he could even consider moves like Rook D8, and if you take on F7, then there's Rook
D1
some
mate threats. Mate,
so
yeah.
But Aronian has many ways to win this game. But it looks like the Armenian player is winning this game.
Of course, Macau is not going to resign yet, but...
Also, the advantage for Aronian is that if he wins this game, he has minimum half-point lead, and he has played everybody who can catch him, which means that he will play someone who has no chance for gold anyway. So there's no direct rival who gets a chance to beat him in the last round. So this is a fantastic situation for Aronian. It really looks like... an Armenian win, and most likely also an Armenian goal.
Of course, in a classical game, probably white would have resigned a few moves before.
But I think he will resign here soon anyway. The threat is bishop e1 attacking the f2 pawn, and to keep the f2 pawn defended is actually difficult. And you also have to keep an eye on a2. No, I think we're gonna see a knockout win for the Armenian in this game. So yeah, you see Wang Hao is smiling and he's resigned. Wow, this was...
Unfortunately, because of some technical problems, we don't see any other. We don't see other boards.
Okay, so we are a bit of a fix here. We can see, right behind us in the picture, we have Viktoria Chmelita of Lithuania, the leader in the female section, and she is playing Harika Dronavali of India, who is she's in seventh place, but she's in shared third place, and she's 1.5 point against behind Chmelita. But should she win this game? She has a serious chance still of fighting for medals, so it's a very important game for both players. And, you can see that they are extremely focused. We have you can see here we have a good view of the tournament hall. You can see some players thinking very, very hard, and everybody will be focused on the game except for Alexander Grishuk, the Russian. He's known for, despite it being blindfolded, he's walking around. Ah, sorry, this is actually Leonard Fresenev.
Welcome to Sport Accord World Mind Games. Welcome to the last round of Chess Blindfold event. Blindfold event is a third part of our chess competition here. We had two tournaments before. It was a Rapid and a Blitz tournament. We are gonna follow the first board in the men's section. The game between Levon Aronian from Armenia and Teimur Rajabov from Azerbaijan. Levon Aronian is a solid leader before the last round. On the second place we have Hikaru Nakamura from United States. It's worth to mention now that Hikaru Nakamura has already 2 silver medals in Blitz and Rapid, so he has a great chance to be the only one player with 3 medals in all 3 competitions. Levon Aronian, which is first, he didn't get any medal so far, so it's his last chance, but he has great chances for a gold one, so...
I think, in fact, if Aronian do not lose this game, he is guaranteed gold.
Yeah, exactly. Draw is enough for him to guarantee a
Even if he loses the game and Nakamura will not win his game, then it will still be Armenian gold, I think. But
and there is still interesting fight for a bronze, because on the third place there is Peter Leko from Hungary. But there are four players just half point below him. Shakhtar Mamedyarov from Azerbaijan, Ding Liren from China, Taimur Rajabov, and Gata Kamsky from United States. So we are expecting a really interesting fight in this last round. And
yeah, it's also interesting that Rajabov is actually 1.5 points behind Aronian. So even if he beats Aronian, he will not be able to catch up. So there is simply no theoretical chance that Rajabov can get gold.
Actually, most of the games are only about the bronze medal.
So it's interesting. Will Rajabov fight very hard to try and win this game, or will he be happy that the Armenian players play solid and forces a draw? If the game is a draw, remember we have an Armenian gold medal, a gold medal by the favorite. So this is no surprise at all. There is also a very interesting situation in the female section. There we have two joint leaders. We have Viktoria Chmelytė of Lithuania and the top favorite Hu Yifan of China. They both have 5 points. It's actually Viktoria Chmelytė who's leading the tournament, because she won the individual encounter. So should they end up on equal amount of points, Viktoria will be ahead of Hu Yifan. But Viktoria is playing Anna Satonsky of United States in the last round. She's trailing Chmelytė with 1 point. But if Satonsky is winning this game, she will have won their individual game and will thus overtake her. But the situation is the following. Is Viktoria Chmelytė will win her game, she is the gold medalist. If Viktoria Chmelytė do not win her game, then Hu Yifan wins gold if she wins her game. If none of them win their game, well, then if they both draw, it's again going to be Chmelytė who gets gold. If Chmelytė loses and Hu Yifan draws, then Hu Yifan takes gold. And in the extreme situation where both Chmelytė and Hu Yifan loses their games, we will have a surprising American gold. So three gold medals are still possible.
So in general, the situation very complicated, and everything is possible still in the female section.
It's a bit surprising we have no moves yet. Well, I think the referee has simply not told the players to start their game yet. Ah, now
yeah,
there
just
it was.
Hands and
so now we are off. And
started.
I think we should have the updates on our screen very soon. But right now we see, yeah, this is blindfold chess. There is no actual physical chessboard. They are just entering their moves in a on the computer screen. And well, we are expecting that we will soon have the moves here on our screen, but right now, no. This is blindfold chess. The players are actually not blindfolded. As you can see, they have nothing covering their eyes because they have to enter those moves. Originally, blindfold chess were played where you were completely blindfolded and you would just tell your opponent, I play d2 to d4. But here it's a bit more organized. They're entering their move.
And actually, d2 and d4 has been played in
exactly. It's a good
Aronian game. You have an update now. And we have, of course, King's Indian.
Well, King's Indian is a fighting opening by Rajabov, but they have played each other a lot of time. They played a lot of King's Indian. I'm sure Aronian is going to choose something very solid.
I mean, actually, it's not clear if it's King's Indian or the Grunfeld now, but we expect King's Indian because of Rajabov with black. So,
but it's interesting. Will Rajabov choose something very risky, or will he choose something safe and allow the game to be a quick draw? A quick draw, as we remember. Well, maybe you can say it's not very brave of Aronian, but a quick draw secures him the gold medal.
Yeah, so but actually, it's not even really clear for Aronian which strategy he should choose. If he should play for a winning as for a win as normal, or he should just try to play very safe. And of course, he's happy with a draw, but objectively, he should just play his best chess. So
this is a typical mistake a lot of players made when they know that if I make a draw in this game, I'm gonna qualify, I'm gonna win, and then they play very passively, and somehow a clever opponent will capitalize on this.
But so I think on this level, I mean, Aronian is so experienced that
I think Aronian knows what you can see. He's very focused and he's trying to concentrate here. Okay,
C5 is already a. Let's say it's a sharp move already.
It's a very popular move these days. And I mean, there is some lines ending in a forced draw, so I will not rule out at all that we could end up with a repetition of moves soon. But let's see. Oh, I think now there is a risk that they will play d5. He will play c takes d5, knight takes d5. And after the move knight b5, black is playing bishop e6. And then after knight d4, he goes back to c8, and they will agree a draw very soon. Okay, this would be...
It's one of possibilities, of course, here, but...
That would be a bit of a disappointment.
Now it depends if Taimur Rajabov wants to fight for this bronze medal, or... Actually...
Or will he just give up and collect another prize? That's that we could see. Oh, we are really risking that this game will be over in a few minutes here. It's if black plays the move d5, yeah, I think now we will see the moves knight b5, bishop e6, knight d4, bishop c8, and the game will be a draw, and we will have a, yeah, they have already agreed a draw. Okay, well, yeah, we are sorry, folks, but these things happen, and, well, we have an Armenian winner here. Levon Aronian has taken gold in the blindfold event. You can see here what happened. He played the move bishop e6, and now after knight d4, the bishop go back, the knight goes back to b5, and they will repeat back and forth.
That's the advantage of white color, that if white really wants to make a draw, usually there are a lot of possibilities to do it.
Actually, they should repeat three times. They only repeated twice. So let's see if there is.
I think it's just not updated yet. And I think
repetition, which means that.
Yeah, it means that even computer counted. So
we have been a bit unlucky, both in the men's and the women's section. In our gold medal matches, there has been a quick repetition of moves. But we can see in the women's section, the fight for gold is still going on, and we will try and talk a bit about what's happening in the female section. Let's just.
I'm trying to get some updates of the second board in the men's section now, but so far I can't.
Yeah. But also in the men's section, gold is decided. We have an Armenian
gold.
Yeah,
gold is decided.
I think we can say very well deserved. Aronia did a good job. He was he played very solid.
He really deserved
good chess, and I think he
deserved
his gold. He had a disappointing tournament so far. This is the women's game. They've just started, as you can see. This is if Victoria Chmelidze wins this game, she's our gold medalist. If she doesn't, then it's most likely Hou Yifan from China. And should she lose, well, then it's Anna Satonsky. But this game has really just started. So this is, but I think we would like to say thanks a lot. It's been really a pleasure doing commentary.
Yeah, it brings us to the end of our live commentary. Thank you for your attention.
And hope.
Okay, last game was not really long, but we hope
see
you
back
really
for
enjoyed
some
the show
some more
anyway.
Chess later. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you for attention.